Orange Sky Audio presents Heal Your Way Forward, The Co-Conspirator's Guide to an Anti-Racist Future by Myisha T. Hill. Dedication, Bell Hooks quote, and the introduction read for you by the author. Narrated for you by Tyra Kennedy.
Dedication. I dedicate this living work to myself as a radical act of self-love. I have finally come home to myself. To anyone whom I have caused harm while trying to find myself as a neurodivergent Black woman in an imperialist, capitalist, white supremacist, ableist world, to all embodying the practice of being whole and human, in the essence of Ubuntu, I am because you are. I want my work to be about healing. Bell Hooks. On December 15th, 2021, I was shaken by the death of Bell Hooks along with the rest of the world. I spent a couple of days on a roller coaster of grief, cycling through emotions. I felt sorry for not visiting Bell Hooks at Berea College. Shame and blame riddled me as I questioned if I'd adequately credited the great elder, now ancestor, for inspiring so much of my work. And so now I ponder at this moment, where do I go from here? How do I accept this loss and grow from it? First, remember, this work is about healing. This work should be rooted in love, and love is, in fact, the work. Bell Hooks said, right now, there is such a profound collective cultural awareness that we need to practice love if we are to heal ourselves and the planet. The task awaiting us is to move from awareness to action. The practice of love requires that we make time, that we embrace change. Bell Hooks was calling us into the practice of love. I want to thank her for inspiring me to move into a love ethic, for calling me into something bigger than myself, for teaching me that, as a Black woman, my words are poignant and powerful, and that writing can be a healing journey. Like Bell Hooks, I want to be remembered not for who I am, but for the work I've done in the world. May the words of this book bring forth divinely inspired transformation, restoration, and justice. Bell Hooks, I thank you for being. Rest well, ancestor. Myisha T. Hill.
Foreword by Aycee Brown. On May 25th, 2020, a video was uploaded on social media. Another unarmed Black man was killed in broad daylight at the hands of cops. But this time was even more traumatic. As George Floyd called out for his mother while a cop had his entire body weight kneeling on his neck, cutting off his circulation. It went viral, and Black and brown people experienced yet another trauma. I tried not to watch the video, but I did. We all tried not to watch it, but we did. Now that day is forever imprinted on our minds. As a young Black girl, I'd seen videos on the news of Rodney King getting beaten by the police. And later in life, I'd seen Eric Garner shout the words, "I can't breathe," while being put in a chokehold as he was getting arrested. But George Floyd was different. The image of him lying on the ground, not resisting, was different. What stood out the most was the look on Derek Chauvin's face. I was familiar with it, the look of superiority. He looked into the camera and didn't care. Even as the cameras recorded him, there was no fear. It immediately brought tears to my eyes as I flashed back to moments of getting pulled over by the cops and calling a friend or my parents just so they could listen in, just in case anything happened to me. even though I'd done nothing wrong or maybe turned a corner too fast or went through a yellow light right before it turned red. When Black people get murdered at the hands of the police, we don't think it's a random case. Our first instinct as Black people is always, that could have been me. It could have been our fathers, mothers, cousins, uncles, aunts, and friends. We don't have the luxury to be exempt from death by police. We have a long history in this country with it. It's in our DNA, and no one should have to hold that much trauma in their bodies, currently or generationally. But as a Black woman in America, my body holds many traumatic memories, including those that I've seen and those that have been passed down to me. All Black and brown people do. The sudden wake-up call that white America experienced in the next few days after the murder of George Floyd threw me and others off guard. I, as well as many other content creators, started speaking out about the disparities in our niches. From calling out big brands to influencers, it was our time to tell the truth of what was really happening behind the scenes. As a Black woman in the spirituality and self-help space, I was angry and went on social media and talked about my own gripes and frustration about not being seen in that sphere. And then I started receiving DMs from people in my industry who hadn't reached out before, even people whom I'd invited on my podcast and never responded. It felt as if they wanted to right years of wrongs with a direct message. It was almost as though for the last 200 years they saw nothing wrong with what was happening in the world, and now they needed to come together and support us. That was the most heartbreaking part of this traumatic event. The performances of non-people of color, from corporations to influencers, the Black Square, the social media break for a week to shine a light on Black and brown creators. I remember a creator saying, "Make sure you all keep that same energy when the dust settles." And the dust has settled and we are back to normal. Well, non-people of color are, but the rest of us still live in this world every day with harsh realities that, yes, we've made progress, but we still have so far to go. A few years before this tragedy, Myisha told me she was going to put all her energy into Check Your Privilege, because she was passionate about educating non-people of color about the disparities in communities, government, religion, and the workplace. She was passionate, and yet she kept hitting brick walls. I remember late-night phone calls filled with tears about what she was trying to do and how no one was hearing her. At times, she questioned what was the point. I would encourage her that her voice needed to be heard. Myisha was working in a religious space and would talk about how racism is so strong in Christianity, and it was making her sick. Her mental health was being jeopardized daily, and it was hard for her most days. Her experiences at her job fueled her passion in doing this work. She was living what she was talking about. I felt her pain, and I knew what it was like to have to keep your mouth closed in order to survive at a job that clearly doesn't have your best interest at heart. Is it unfair that when things are blatantly racist at work, you feel your livelihood is on the line? Being quiet doesn't fix the problem, but speaking up is so risky. And that's a reality for many Black and brown folks. Black and brown folks in the workplace have had to silence ourselves in spaces that are predominantly white, so we wouldn't seem like troublemakers. I would tell her to keep fighting, keep educating. She did. And thank goodness she did. Myisha kept fighting for awareness around these issues, and she finally began to receive it. And yet, there is still so much work to be done. There are still so many eyes that haven't been opened. But how do we do this work without breaking our backs educating white people? How do we make change without becoming the morality police? I truly don't know, but I do know that it starts with inclusion. Including more Black and Brown folks in spaces that are predominantly white, such as conferences, corporate boards, educational boards, and politics. We need to be seen in these spaces because our voices matter. But our counterparts have to be willing to go against the grain and include us. They have to invite us in. It's time for healing, but what most white people need to know is that there is no prize for healing and change. Many speak of inclusion, but are you yourself ready to be inclusive? Because in order to do this work, there must be radical transparency. There must be a willingness to make real change that involves action. Is this possible? Yes, but only for those who are ready. Ready to leave behind the old constructs that don't benefit Black and Brown people. For this, Myisha has the answers. She has the answers to help the non-performance of change. Because an anti-racist future looks like non-POC people extending a helping hand and making their resources available to us. It includes being open to hearing about the disparities without being defensive. It means non-POC people healing their own biases about Black and Brown folks and choosing to do better and not just talking about it. Myisha is working toward helping us all heal and have an understanding of what that looks like for both sides. She's educating, informing, and providing tools for change. She's shining a light on systematic racism. It's going to take time, just like anything, but it can be done. And it's going to take a collective effort. That starts with you listening to this book. It starts with you having uncomfortable conversations. It starts with you calling out the people around you because you know better, so it's your responsibility to do better. This is your moment to rewrite history and be a change agent in this lifetime. Don't miss your opportunity to do so.
Introduction. Not everything that is faced can be changed, but nothing can be changed until it is faced. James Baldwin. I am Black and beautiful. Like you, my life has been full of nuance and trauma. And as an ode to Langston Hughes' native son, we can say that my life isn't no crystal stair. In fact, according to some, I have been a societal misfit. But I believe our stories are sacred, and it is through our individual and collective stories that we learn more about ourselves and the greater collective. Story captures us and teaches us insights for the future. Storytelling connects us and heals us forward. In my ancestral lineage, we used oral storytelling so that we could learn from the mistakes of the past. More than 14 generations ago, my ancestors, members of the Akan tribe in Ghana, left through their door of no return. The stories that unfolded from there not only form the basis of my personal history, but of the collective history of the culture in which I, and likely you, grew up. I was born in Cook County Hospital on the south side of Chicago. My parents were never married, and I was raised by my mama, grandmother, and the maternal side of my family. On my father's side, my older brothers and my grandmothers maintained connection with me throughout childhood. I was loved, nurtured, and nourished via matriarchy and Western Christianity, all of which made me feel I didn't belong in this world. According to white culture, I've always been seen as inadequate, inferior, and a failure. But I wasn't raised to believe the myth of white supremacy or anti-Blackness. In fact, I was raised to appreciate my heritage, serve my community, and know my place as a Black woman in the world, which meant don't rock the boat, stir up trouble, or speak too loudly. I grew up socially with John, but I didn't know I had a choice. I was told not to speak and to only be seen.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.